was very painful to listen to your presentation. I wanted to go to war, and I can go to war because of that presentation. But I'm from South Africa, and you know what is happening in South Africa right now with the attacks. You are from the African Union. Is there a way that we as Africans in the continent and in the diaspora can really take seriously the issue of preparation to an extent that we can leave the universities and go to war so that our children can have. My first love is soccer, so when you talk about Liverpool, you know, but the brutality that happened, how do we get back to Kwame Nkrumah, to the militant Mandela, Nyerere, and deal with reparation for our generation?
Can I just respond to these two before I forget
yes.
the trends?
Thank you. I believe the first question is about the instances of brutality in the course of the trade and how to link it up to the generalized unrest which ensued as a result and which intensified in this trade. You imagine a situation where in a period of say 400 years all that we know is you find a ship on the horizon, and then our people start mobilizing to attack people, arrest people, and sell them. This happened over a period of 400 years. In such a period, first of all, you try to escape from attack. You don't have any time to do agriculture. You don't have any time to continue your cultural studies. The whole period is a period of general confusion. People attack each other. It becomes part of the system. Our chiefs now try to get enriched by the trinkets and the gins and the wines brought from abroad. The courts are influenced. They're looking for every opportunity to sentence people and send them away. They become partners in the whole business of disintegrating, destroying everything else by the slave trade. There were instances where slave traders, and most of them were Africans, because the Europeans would not go into the bush. All they had to do was to give European goods to the chiefs and the powers that be, supply them with arms, ensure that one tribe quarrels the other, supply both tribes with arms, and just sit back and enjoy the loot. And this continues in increasing geometric intensity with increasing sophistication over a period of 400 years. So all culture was destroyed. It is a miracle that some states existed, and some states were enlisted in this process. So Africans became the enemies of Africans, tribes became the enemies of tribes, tribalism was intensified, suspicion grew among people. In such a situation, no progress can be made. This is what generally existed in that period. Until slowly, as a result of the abolition and the enforcement of the abolition, peace slowly came to these lands, and the Europeans began to see that there were other ways of making profits by trading with Africa. So trade began in palm oil, cotton, other vegetables and stuff. But at the height of this, there was a British governor who tried to set up plantations in Cape Coast, and the British Board of Trade decreed that it should stop because Africans were to be encouraged to sell each other as slaves. So this was, if you can imagine, this kind of violence over a period of 4 centuries, this was what prevailed. It is a miracle that anybody survived at all, because in some places where this clash of cultures occurred, like the Arawak Indians, they were exterminated. So we're lucky that we survived. Now, as the issue of reparations, that is a very sensitive topic. Clearly, since the Durban summit of the United Nations, where the resolution decreed that the slave trade was a crime against humanity, and it being a crime against humanity, there ought to be consequences against the perpetrators. The complex thing is that the perpetrators are the most powerful countries, and their accomplices, who are the most powerful people in the countries which suffered. So it becomes a little difficult. But the concept has to be developed. There was a time when a young lawyer, Miss Palmer Farmer, in America, brought an action against an insurance company that in her research, she had discovered that the company was involved, had financed the slave trade, and members of her family had been at the receiving end. And the US court actually granted her some reparations, which was paid, I think, by Brown University, because that university, a very popular Ivy League university, had its funds from people who indulged in this slave trade. But this was at the level of individuals. Now, if you want to talk about reparations generally, you're talking at the level of countries, and you're talking at a level of international, a level of public international law. One is not sure how to proceed in this matter. I think that you could talk about proceeding along the legal route, but also we have to acknowledge that you need to build up public opinion to such an extent that the public is ready to accept that this slave trade is a running sore, is a crime that has to be addressed. And I believe part of this engagement is trying to propagate ideas which eventually lead to some reparation. The question is, what form is the reparation going to take? There are people who think that they should be assigned various sums of money in foreign exchange to go and spend as a result of reparation. Others think that this should only be given to people in the Caribbean or United States. Others think that some should come to Africa. But all those are details. The issue that we have to find out is whether in law, in history, in politics, there is a case that when damage of such extent has occurred, we should find a way to try and repair that damage if further irreparable damage is not going to continue. That's my view, sir. Thank you.
Very briefly, we have a question from someone who is online on the Skype. And this is Kevin Lewis out of New Jersey. And he says, For clarification, it was mentioned that the British abandoned slavery on their own as a result of their meeting. What role do you think the Africans themselves played in influencing the British to abolish slavery? And what were those specific impacts? He says, does he feel it was the influence of the Africans in rebellion that forced the British to make this decision after seeing Haiti, Sam Sharp, and others?
There are two hands up there.
I'd like to first thank you for the opportunity to.
I would just like to.
I would like to thank you for the opportunity to come out and speak with us about this subject. My question is, do you think Africa will ever take any responsibility in the slave trade? As we talk about reparation from those countries in the West America and Europe and all, do you think that Africa will ever take any responsibility for this atrocity?
Thank you, Vice Chair. I appreciate being here today and being a part of this forum because it's very much needed. I also want to comment about the thing about the abolishment, the British felt the need that they're trying to imply that they felt it in their heart that they were doing some type of just by abolishing slavery. It's obvious to me that the resistance was so great from the African ancestors that they had to come up with something, because the examples that they did in front of so many of the enslaved Africans, because we were Africans. We were Africans, we weren't Negroes, we weren't Blacks, we were Africans. And the example that they set in front of us by cutting off the heads and hanging us on poles and castrating us and cutting off our ears and cutting off our fingers and legs and posting us up for years in front of people, that had to be effective in so many ways that our people said, no, we gonna keep fighting. And I know for a fact that it was the resistance that so many of us were able to survive out of all of that they did to us, because it makes me cringe when I hear all of the explanations of so many and so many stories. Professor Smalls had gave us a book of resistance. It was so much resistance all over the place. We have so many people that we don't even know about, or even, that's why we should always thank the ancestors, the known and unknowns, because there's so many that we do not know that resisted against this atrocity and all of this evilness. And my second thing that I want to say is, there still needs to be a war raged on these people because their descendants are still here. They are still doing this to us right now. We are still suffering right now. I've been living in Ghana for 10 years, over 10 years, and I suffer right now because I want so much to be a part of being here and be and put into place where I'm supposed to help and assist. If I can assist him, the vice chair, if anybody that we can assist as Africans of the diaspora, we want to do our part. But nobody is putting us in positions or allowing us. We even can just take our place and do whatever it needs to be done, because we know these crackers. We was in the house with them. Put their hands on us. They raped our women. They raped our mothers, our grandmothers. And they still getting away with it because they marched through here with a young girl. And they take babies. I'm on airplanes going back and forth just so I can build something for my children. And there's a six-month-old or one-year-old African child with two white people, and the baby is crying so hard and reaching out to me, and there's nothing that I can do. There's nothing that I can do. The baby is begging me to take him, because I look just like him. We all the same people. And that baby wants to, somebody help me. These people got me, they done promised and gave their parents some small trinkets and told them they gonna give them a good life in America, and they stolen these children, and they continue to prance around America with these babies. And the babies are suffering. There's nothing that I can do. I just cry. I'm a grandmother. I have three grandchildren. I cry all the time on the inside. When I wake up in the morning, my son, he is in the U.S., I cry on the inside. Now, you might not see tears, but I'm always crying because I believe that something could happen to any one of my offspring right now while I'm standing in here with you. But we have got to rage war. Some type of way we got to come together and sit at a forum and make something happen. Some changes need to be coming. We need to stop talking. We need to do it right now. I'm ready.
Thank you, my sister. I'm crying with you too. The first question was the role of Africans in abolition. Clearly, there was always resistance. There was always resistance. The point is that the writing of our history was never neutral. At a certain point in time, it was even presented as if the slave trade was the greatest thing that ever happened to Africa. As if, I've read books by African Americans who thank God that the ancestors survived the Middle Passage. They go to America. The truth is that this history brings about so much emotion, but it's important, if you want to address the issues, to put emotion aside and look at cold facts and analyze things properly. It's about studying our history, it's about organization. So getting a point of view across, and this doesn't happen overnight. This grows slowly until the consciousness has gripped a large part of the masses. Now, it is when this consciousness has gripped the masses that it becomes a material force that can be used to organize and to channel resistance and ways of repairing the damage. But the first step is to go into our history and find the truth about what actually happened. And I believe that's the state that we are. We are still in the quest for the truth. I am digging for the truth. I don't have it all. I'm seeking to know more. And if you are able to grasp this truth, if you are able to transmit it to as large a population as possible, then we can begin to have legislators in places that can move motions to have some of this repaired done. But no matter how angry we are, no matter how emotional we are, we need, and I know this is difficult, we need to be able to put emotions aside and go and find the facts. Because the facts are there. And if you struggle, we find them. Then we can begin to have our actions informed by science and technology and history. Then we can make some progress. That's all I can tell you.
There are a few more hands on this side. So there are two people here.
Some hands on the other. All right.
Where is
that? I just wanted to give a comment or introduce yourself.
On the relation, of abolition, very often academics and even mystics and other commentaries that very often took the thing in a very diluted manner.
See, the British
just got out, and then all of a sudden met and then decided to bring about abolition. But the integrity of the issue should be critically looked at, especially if you consider other writings outside the jurisdiction of Britain. For example, the Swedish philosopher named Emanuel Swedenborg. He wrote a text entitled Heaven and Hell. In fact, it was that text that then brought about
the revolution in Britain itself.
In that text, he related
two main things.
He said
that
the black man was the highest of God's creation. And secondly, he said that at the end of what we sometimes call the end of the world, the black man would emancipate. Those two things pricked the conscience of the British monarch and their people, and then emancipation began through those who read that material, especially those who had the Jewish background into that. You have to deal with the issue very seriously. But sometimes the balance, and then.
So he has the answer, and then he has the answer. And please keep your contributions short so that you have time to.
Hotel. Thank you for this privilege. I have a question. I'm a Ghanaian. That I found out that all these three issues that you're saying, all this history, all this powerful history about slavery, many of the Ghanaian citizens don't even know about the slavery thing that has happened in this land. There are a lot of Ghanaian citizens who school here, from kindergarten to the university, all the universities in Ghana here, don't even know where the slave castles are. People live in Jamestown, Jamesport, don't even know the meaning of Usherford, Jamesport. They don't know the use of it. They thought it was prison built by Ghanaian or built by the Ghanaian government, putting people over there. They don't even know that those things were built by the so-called colonialists or the exploiters. So, what are you doing? Doing so that citizens of Ghanaians will know that this thing happened in their land? Because as I'm saying right now, things are going on in Ghanaians because Ghanaian citizens are confused because they don't even know their history. So being a Ghanaian citizen, because if I did not travel outside this country to most of European countries, and at the end, I ended up in the United States, I wouldn't have known who I am, how powerful, how precious I was. I left the shores to Europe and finally settled in the United States before I even know that, I'm very, very valuable and very, very respected and expensive. And I'm, yeah. Because I'm working here just like that, like every other Ghanaian here in this university. Don't even know they have this history. So my question is, what are the educationalists doing so that we could start this history right from the beginning, from the kindergarten to the tertiary levels?
Yeah.
very much, my brother. I think you hit the nail on the head. It's about education. It's about the accurate knowledge of our history. And it's about realization that knowledge is not neutral. We have our interests. Others may have their interests. Now, whoever was responsible for the slave trade and colonialization and all that, he will write his history in a way to justify his actions. We have come across textbooks where when they talk about the slave trade at all, they talk about advantages and disadvantages. We've been through high school. We've been through primary school. Now, you should ask yourself, in whose interest are we being educated in this matter? I mean, I was in primary school here. We used to march in the afternoon sun, singing in the bleak midwinter. It is not by accident. No, it is not by accident. So, this matter is of an order of complexity greater than you imagine. It involves politics, it involves law, it involves government, it involves commitment. I mean, I've been to Cape Coast Castle with tourists from the Caribbean, and as we look over the wall, finding where the guns are pointed, as you look down, there are Cape Coastians squatting and defecating. They have no knowledge at all, not an inkling of the valuable history which is looking at them everywhere. So there's a lot of work to be done. And it's not the work of any particular person, it's the work of everybody who is conscious and wants to bring about a change. It's not a work of government, it involves universities, it involves everybody. Because this trade involved all of us, its effects have affected all of us. We are all looked upon as niggers wherever we go. We have to live with it. But what it means is that there's work to be done for all of us.
Good afternoon, Deputy Chair. I appreciate you for being here. But I wanted to speak to a couple of things, and I'll be very brief.
Very brief, sister.
The first one, actually, I can limit it to one. The first one, and the only most important one, is from when I heard you speak of the fact of emotion being put into things that are discussed. Without emotion, there will be no motion. We cannot sit into a room and discuss the things that you should and not embody the emotion. The emotion will change the way that the parent raises the child, in turn which will change the second and third generation. So we must invoke the emotion from our ancestors to keep us pushing forward. It was the series of the documentaries that we watched today. It was emotion that made a man stop a desert. It was emotion that made a sister in Kenya plant trees to stop basically the erosion of the environment. So it is emotion that all of us have in this room to put into those that come after us to make them sit in your chair in the future. To make the direct change that can bring us home to a place, any country that we choose to settle. To me and my answer and my objectivity, that should be the role of the AU, and I'm just one person, just one 45-year-old male. The African Union should be for us to come home,
yes,
wherever we are, and for us to come home here back into our own mindset and be done as Africans. That's all I have to say. Thank you for listening.
Question, but my brother over there handled that for me, so I'll move on to my second question. I guess it's an opinion question. Why do you feel the Arab slave trade isn't as discussed as the European slave trade? I believe that by looking into that more, we find out, first of all, we find out more about our history because the Arab slave trade predated the European slave trade. And also, furthermore, what we learn is these studies will show that most of the tribes are now made up of what is called Ghana, only came here because of massive slavery incursions from the north from the Arabs in the first place, and the whole slave culture that resulted. So what I would not know is why you feel that the Arab slave trade isn't covered as much. You are based in Ethiopia, so I'm sure that is discussed much more at length there. I've got a Sudanese friend who gives me a lot of insight because being Sudanese, they interact with the Arabs much more, so they get that side of the history much more than we here in West Africa and other sort of South Saharan African country.
So the last intervention.
Sorry. Thank you. My question has already been covered, and I'm grateful that you acknowledge the future of the healing. And when we talk about reparation, I want to touch on that because people say reparation pay me money. Paying you money for reparation is like is the same value, it's the same commodity. But one of the reparations Africa can give, you don't have to wait for money, which I know is right in your power to do it. You see, I know a lot of people who are in the diaspora, they claim they will come to Africa and they'll become illegal immigrants. There's a woman now, she's still almost 18 years in Cape Town. She's fighting, she's going to be deported. Their press is there. And so it's actually the diaspora because they leave, but they're never arriving anyway. We are shifting them from here to America. They want to come here. And so you pick something you feel you can do, which I know is in your power, which the ancestor will give you strength to do, is to say, okay, let these people come. Because normally, when they come here, they have their own money. And then, you know, about African religion, they are the main proponent of African religion. Unlike us who are exporting our Pentecostal church here, they are coming here. And you can see how much it has, it's helping youth, consciousness, even reggae. People, most people now, if you see, they are connected to this, they fall less into drugs and get into consciousness. So that is, sir, please.
My brother, I agree with you, and we'll see what we can do. Now, as to the Arab slave trade, why I didn't talk too much about Arab slave trade. The truth is that I don't know too much about it. I'm trying to find out more about it. What I know is that the intensity and its relationship to the development of the international capitalist economy are slightly different. And because the transatlantic slave trade affected the international economy so dramatically, it's probably the reason why much more has arisen about it. But I agree with you, one is to find out more about the Arab slave trade, to have a complete picture of the damage that was done to us in our history.
Thank you very much. I'm happy our speaker is the deputy chair for the AU. We are talking about the transatlantic slave trade elite effect, but what are we doing about our youth who, even though we assume slavery has been abolished, who are dying on the Mediterranean Sea every day trying to go and re-enslave themselves? Thank you.
Talk about reparation. I googled the word and it has to do with making amends. And I find it funny that up till now we don't seem to get that if we don't expect amends we can move on. That's my problem. I feel like a person has broken your heart, a guy or a girl, and you're in your corner thinking, I'm not going to move on. They won't apologize. I will never get closure. So you're just there. You're not doing anything in your life. You're just thinking about everything and how he hurt you or how she hurt you. But then another individual had her heart broken. And he said, okay, how have I learned from this? How is this going to make me a better person? How am I going to teach people in the future? You know, I don't think we need to waste time on asking people to give us anything. We don't want anything from them anymore. That's what we should focus on now. Like, the problem is that it's in our minds. And if we keep expecting to get something, we'll go nowhere. So, like, this thing hurts, but we need to learn to let it go and, like, you know, focus on the future. So that's my comment.
For his lecture this afternoon, and it was very, very painful to listen to it. I felt the pain of my ancestors. I was born in Jamaica, and myself and my husband, we repatriated to Ghana 14 years ago. And my ancestors, they didn't want to leave Africa. They were forced to leave. They wanted to come back. And unfortunately, they didn't come back, but they sent me. They sent me to represent, and I'm here to represent in Ghana, the pain and the suffering my ancestors went through. Now, what I want from Ghana is for Ghana to recognize that I am Ghanaian. And I'm saying, Mr. Quartey, you are now the vice president of the AU. I want the AU to take my requisition forward. I want to be an African and be recognized as an African.
Thank you very much. To attempt to respond to these questions from the last, I am very touched by the Jamaican sister. But I'm surprised that she says she wants to be an African. I think you're already an African. At the time that President Mahama signed the decree providing Ghanaian nationality to our 35 or 37 diasporas who've been here for some time, the word he used was that your citizenship has been restored. That is to say, you never even lost it.
That's right.
You know, all that has happened in history has been an attempt to deprive us of our humanity, but we're still here, and we intend to stay here. And we can only do that by deepening our knowledge of history. My sister at the back said that all that is history, let's look forward. I'm afraid I would disagree with that.
Yes, yes.
It was Winston Churchill, who was never really our best friend as Africans, who said, the further back you look, the further forward you can see.
That's right.
There you are. So I think our history is very relevant. The important thing is that we have to make sure that we sift the facts we tell our story properly and truly. Because believe me, not all the history books that we have read have told the African story truly. And it is not by accident. Part of it is to try and glorify their history and diminish ours so that we are perpetually, intellectually, psychologically, and mentally enslaved to their mode of thinking. But even that has not succeeded. Now, with your permission, I'd like to read a short paragraph written by a British governor of Jamaica. And he was talking about a rebellion of black slaves in Jamaica in 1760. So, if you permit me, let me just read. He says, Coromantins in the 1760 rebellion. Now you know Coromantin village is on the way to Cape Coast. See, the circumstances which distinguish the Coromantin or Gold Coast Negroes from all others are firmness
both of body and mind. A ferociousness of disposition, but without activity, courage, and a stubbornness of what an ancient Roman would have deemed an elevation of soul, which prompts them to enterprises of difficulty and danger, and enables them to meet death in its most horrible shape with fortitude or indifference. They sometimes take to labor with great promptitude and alacrity, and have constitutions well adapted for it. For many of them have undoubtedly been slaves in Africa. I've interrogated great numbers on this subject. On the other hand, the Gold Coast being inhabited by various different and other tribes, which are engaged in perpetual warfare and hostility with each other, there cannot be a doubt that many of the captives taken in battle were taken in battle and sold in European settlements were of free condition in their native country. It is not wonderful that such men should endeavor, even by means the most desperate, to regain their freedom of which they have been deprived. Nor do I conceive that any further circumstances are necessary to prompt them to action than that of being sold in captivity in a distant country. I mean to state the facts as I find them. Such I well know was the origin of the Negro Rebellion, which happened in Jamaica in 1760. It arose at the instigation of a Coromantee Negro of the name Taki. People here recognize the name as Taki Akrama, who had been a chieftain in Guinea and broke out on the frontier plantation in St. Mary's Parish, belonging to the late Ballard Bedford, an adjoining estate of Trinity, the property of the deceased relation, the Benefactor Zachary Trinity. On those plantations were upwards of 100 Gold Coast Negroes, newly imported, and I do not believe that an individual among them had received the least shadow of ill treatment from the time of their arrival here. I will not call it. This is to give you an indication of the perception of the Negro African from the point of view of somebody who enslaved them and was interested in keeping them enslaved. But even he had to acknowledge that the African has something of spirit within him. So don't be surprised if there's a tendency to paint the African as naive and dumb and useless. There's a purpose to it. And the whole point of our being here is to educate ourselves to be able to counter some of this propaganda, because education is our greatest weapon. We are not ready to go to war yet, but with education, we can achieve so much. Thank you.
Can we give Ambassador a large round of to close a meeting, and it's because I can see all these hands up. People really want to continue with this conversation, and I think we should see this as the middle of a conversation, which maybe began many years ago. All of us are very interested in this topic because it's really critical, and I think he said it well when he said one should really look far back in one's history to be able to go further forward. So let's pledge that we will continue this conversation. I know there are many unresolved issues that we've been discussing. For example, we've been discussing the role of Africans in the slave trade. We've been discussing questions of resistance and how much of it had to do with the how much was resistance the reason for the abolition of the slave trade. We've also been looking at questions of reparation and the debates about what reparations should look like and how they should be organized. There are many, many more such questions. There was a question about Arab slavery and how it changed the continent even before the transatlantic slave trade. So there are many, many things that we should continue to discuss and to research so that we can bring this conversation to fruition. Because I think as long as
There are so many of us who are very unhappy with our history and feel as if we have not been heard and it has not been clarified what went on. We are not likely to move forward. So I really, really want this conversation to go on. And I hope that as the Institute of African Studies, we can play our small part in continuing these conversations. So I promise you, this is not the end. And you can actually corner my brother here as soon as he walks out there to ask him some of the questions he couldn't ask. But I want us to continue talking, even after today. So have a good evening. Thank you so much for coming. And thank you.
All right, and as we close out, we have a quick announcement. And one of our PhD students, Mr. Sela Ajay, will actually be having an exhibit on a very similar topic, and it's entitled Staying Alive, Slavery, Neo-Slavery, Repatriation, and the Myth of Africa's Past. And that will be on 6 March at the Brazil House in Jamestown, and it will go from 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. And our speakers will be Prof. Mauli Ajay and Dr. Obadile Kamba. So be sure to be there, and we can continue that discussion there for sure.